Look at our experience right now, please.
At the best of our nations, that is to be proud of. I want to weigh in.
Abounding many opportunities for everyone who considers Zimbabwe as a whole.
expectations might be high in the mix, I have no doubt that over time we will appreciate the solid foundation laid by my predecessors against all manner of resistance towards building an educated, enlightened, skilled, and forgiving society. This is a formidable head start we draw from our past, a pivot upon which to build developments in the present and to erect hopes for the future. Fellow countrymen, Zimbabweans, as we chart our way forward, we must accept that our challenges as a nation emanate in part from the manner in which we have managed our politics, both national and international. However, given our historical realities, we wish the rest of the world to understand and appreciate that the policies and programs related to land reform were inevitable. Whilst there is a lot we may need to do by way of outcomes, the principle of repossessing our land cannot be challenged or reversed. The dispossession of our ancestral lands was the fundamental reason for waiting the liberation struggle. It would be a betrayal of the brave men and women who sacrificed their lives if we were to reverse the gains we have made in reclaiming our land. Therefore, I exhort beneficiaries of the land reform program to show their deservedness by demonstrating commitment to the utilization of the land now available to them for national food security and for recovery of our economy. They must take advantage of programs that my government shall continue to campaign to ensure that all land is utilized optimally. To that end, my government will capacitate the land commission so that it sees all outstanding issues related to land redistribution. My government is committed to compensating those farmers from whom they were taken in terms of our law of land. And to recall in the future complex issues of land tenure we have to be addressed both actively and definitively. We dare not prevaricate on this key issue. Events leading to this historic day attest to the fact that we are a unique nation, one which is clear about what it wants and what it does not want. Ordinarily, many nations, including those in the developed world, would not have ended with the sort of outcome we celebrate today. Credit goes to every Zimbabwean and my predecessor who invested a lot towards a peaceful resolution of the challenges of the situation that had arisen in our country. From events preceding this occasion, we stand apart as a unique nation driven by mutual tolerance, peace and unity, which we have displayed in the past few weeks. This is a wonderful world, indeed a proud page we have added to the science of conflict resolution and settlement. That peace and harmony should be characteristic of how we relate to one another before, during, and after the 2018 harmonized democratic elections next year. I commit to you today that these elections will be held as scheduled. Today, however, the Republic of Zimbabwe renews itself by governing well towards ensuring that the pillars of democracy in our land are strengthened and respected. We fully reaffirm our membership of the family of nations and express our commitment to playing our part in all regional, continental, and international organizations and arrangements in order to make a modest contribution towards a prosperous and a peaceful world order. We subscribe and affirm the principle where all nations of the world are equal and sovereign partners working towards the maintenance of world peace as collectively cherished under the United Nations Charter. Here at home, we must however appreciate the fact that over the years, our domestic politics will become poisoned and rampant and polarizing. My goal is to persuade and preside over a polity and run an administration that recognizes strength in our diversity as a people, hoping that this position, a well-meant stance, will be reciprocated and radiated to cover all our groups, organizations, and communities. We dare not squander the moment. Whatever we do or choose not to do must be intended to benefit all our people. Above all, we must always remember and realize that we hold and run this country in trust. It belongs to future generations whose possibilities must never be foreclosed or mortgaged as a result of decisions of expediency. The values of unity and peace cherished by all Zimbabweans are the enduring foundations for the desired goal of development. It's the third pillar of the Trinity, unity, peace, and development, espoused by my partisan peers. Our economic policy will be predicated on our agriculture, our command agriculture, which is the mainstay and on creating conditions for an investment-led economic recovery that puts a premium on job creation. Key choices will have to be made to attract foreign direct investment, to tackle high levels of unemployment while transforming our economy. The main skills Zimbabweans who have left the country over the years for a variety of reasons must now come into the broad economic calculus designed for our recovery and takeoff as a nation. Of course, the fiscal and the social infrastructure must be repaired and expanded to position our country in readiness for economic growth, employment creation, equity, freedom, and democracy, and for the provision of vital social goals, principally health, shelter, clean water, education, and other key social services. Our pace for economic development must be premised on our timeless goal to establish and sustain a just and equitable society firmly based on our historical, cultural and social experience, as well as on our aspirations for better lives for all our people. Our system of economic organization and management will incorporate elements of the market economy in which enterprise is allowed, encouraged and protected. The fabulous natural resources we have as a country must now be exploited for the national good. We welcome mutually gainful partnerships with international investors whose presence in our midst must be valued and secured. The bottom line is an economy which is back on its feet. Only that way can we recover this economy, create jobs for our youths, and reduce poverty for all our people. We must witness real positive changes in our lives. In the immediate, the liquidity challenges which have bedeviled the economy must be tackled head on, with real solutions being generated as a matter of urgency. People must be able to access their earnings and their savings as and when they need them. As we focus on recovering our economy, we must shed misbehaviors and the acts of indiscipline which have characterized the past. Acts of corruption must stop.
Change now.
recognizing the pivotal role that exports play in generating much-needed foreign currency, government will ensure relaxation of export procedures, whilst vigorously ensuring the reduction of all costs associated with the conduct of international trade. The establishment of special economic zones will be accelerated in order to attract investment and increase exports. The maintenance of economic stability and confidence amongst the transacting public, the local business community, and foreign investors remains key to our reform agenda. My government will ensure financial sector viability and stability. We will put in place measures that encourage saving through bank deposits and other appropriate financial instruments, which bring fair rewards to depositors. The current banking culture, where costs are left on depositors, must come to an end. To reduce the high country risk perception among existing and prospective investors, government will henceforth ensure that its domestic and internal debt obligations are serviced. This will apply to the whole of government, including local authorities and state-owned enterprises. In addition, my government will proactively curb externalization of foreign currency and the smuggling of goods. The country's border management and control systems will be strengthened. I intend to approach security issues from a broad human, physical, and social perspective. All citizens must feel secure and enjoy a sense of belonging in their land. All activities that national security institutions aim to achieve must be focused on overall human security, to include, among others, security from disease, hunger, unemployment, literacy, and extreme poverty. We must pay equal attention to all these areas, enhancing the capabilities of our security services so that they are able to deal decisively with all threats. Today, the Republic of Zimbabwe enters the second phase of its birth. We emerge to fully affirm our belonging to the family of nations. We have no ill or belligerent intentions against any other nation. The Southern African Development Community, SADC, is our home. We founded it from its beginning, and we commit ourselves to furthering its vision and ideals. As we journey outward from our SADC house, we fully realize that we belong in the bigger house and family, African Union. Whilst we were not free at the birth of the OAU, which championed the total liberation of the entire African continent from colonialism, we were creators of standing efforts of OAU through its liberation committee. The African Union itself, the sequel to the OAU, is our national home and a collective resource as Africans. Zimbabwe pledges its untrammeled membership and declares here and now that it will play its role fully to make a success of the AU. An important subset of the AU is the COMESA Economic Group of Nations. There, we are committed to contributing meaningfully to the realization of the AU Agenda 2063. Zimbabwe's journey since independence has provided us with many lessons, some pleasant, others not so pleasant. In particular, some bigger nations have attempted to make us bend to their dictates. We have, however, successfully maintained good relations with the preponderant majority of the family of nations. I stand here today to say that our country is ready and willing to start re-engagement with all the nations of the world. As we build a new democratic Zimbabwe, we ask those who have punished us in the past to reconsider the economic and political sanctions against us. Whatever misunderstandings may have subsisted in the past, let this make way for a new beginning. In this global world, no nation is, can, or need be an island. Isolation has never been splendid and viable. Solidarity and partnerships are and will always be the way. We are ready to embrace each and all on the principles of mutual respect and common humanity. We will take definite steps to re-engage those nations who have had issues with us in the past. Equally, we will take measures to ensure that we acknowledge and show commitment towards setting our debts. But of course, our resources remain scarce, especially at this stage when we face a myriad of pressures. But we count on the goodwill of those we owe to give us a chance. We remain committed to honoring the debts and entering into new relationships. I wish to be clear. All foreign investment will be safe in Zimbabwe. We will willfully abide by the terms of bilateral investment promotion and protection agreements, which we have concluded with a number of nations. I ask you to join us in exploiting our potential to make a difference in the lives of our people. The United Nations is the home of all the nations on this planet. We will contribute with overall thinking and management of world affairs. Our plain talk arises from our deep convictions and desire to help build world peace. We join the rest of the continent in calling for reforms in the United Nations system so the world body becomes truly representative and does command universal respect. Zimbabwe will continue to contribute to international peace and security, aiding the granting of full statehood and freedoms to the Palestinian and Sahrawi peoples. Let us together honestly address the sources of instability and terrorism in many parts of the world, all within the framework of the United Nations. Honorable guests and people of Zimbabwe, I wish to thank all of you here and elsewhere who wish us a peaceful transition. For the time that I shall be president of Zimbabwe, I solemnly promise that I shall, to the best of my ability, serve everyone who calls and considers Zimbabwe their home. I encourage all of us to remain peaceful, even as preparations for political contestations for next year's harmonized, free and fair elections gather momentum. The voice of the people is the voice of God. Brothers and sisters, the people of Zimbabwe, the task before us is much bigger than competing for political office. Let us all play our part to build this great country together as Zimbabweans. May God bless Zimbabwe. And thank you.